Now, before we dive into the course content, I'd like to give you a teaser or a taste of what you'll be able to do by the end of the course. So this is going to be one example that's based on one topic that's covered in one subsection of the course. Now, because this is a teaser lecture, I'm not going to explain the technical aspect of how am I doing this, because I'm going to teach you how to do this as you go through the course. For now, just sit back and enjoy this lecture. And after this lecture, we're going to dive into the course content where you'll learn how to do things like this and much, much more. So in this example, we're going to be hacking this Windows 11 computer from this hacking machine. In the first section of the course, I'm going to show you how to set up your hacking lab, including this hacking machine and the target Windows machine. But for now, what I want to do is I want to hack this computer from this hacking machine. Now, the attack that I'm going to show you right now and everything that I show you throughout the course works on Windows 11 and Windows 10 and previous versions. But for now, I'm using Windows 11 because it's the latest. And the way that I'm going to hack that computer, mainly, I'm going to be using a framework called Beef. Beef is a browser exploitation framework that allows us to run a number of attacks against a target browser. Now, for us to be able to use Beef, we have to inject Beef's code into the target browser. So we have to actually inject Beef's code into the browser of the target computer, which happens to be Chrome in this example. Now we're going to use another program called BetterCap in order to inject Beef's hook code automatically into the target browser. So the target user will not even know that they clicked or did something suspicious. Now I've already configured BetterCap to do that. So I'm simply just going to run it by giving it my network interface and giving it a script that I'm calling here spoof.cap that will place me in the middle of the connections, allowing BetterCap to inject the hook code of Beef into the browser of the target. Now I'm going to show you how to do this, how to use BetterCap, and how to write this script yourself as we go through the course. So this is just a teaser for you to enjoy. Do not worry about the technicalities. So I'm going to simply run it. And now BetterCap is going to intercept all the data that will be sent and received from this computer. And the last step, I'm going to run a caplet that is called HSTS hijack caplet. This script will allow us to downgrade connections and inject Beef's code into the browser. Again, I'm going to show you how to write that script and use it later on in the course. So just watch it and enjoy. So I'm simply going to hit enter to run that. And as you can see, we get no errors, meaning that everything is running successfully. And I'm also in here, if you look at the top part of my terminal window, I'm actually listening for incoming connections, because eventually the end goal is I want to be able to receive a connection from the target computer from my backdoor so that I can control their computer and do anything I want on it. So right now I'm listening for incoming connections. So when my attack is successful, I will get a connection in here. So let's go ahead to the target computer and simply run the browser. So we're assuming that this is the normal target user. They run their browser and, for example, they go to google.ie in order to just browse the internet or search for something that is interesting to them. Now, when this happens, BetterCap is going to automatically inject the hook code for Beef. And if we go to Beef, you can see that now we have a new online browser. So right now, Beef is connected to this browser right here. This browser is hooked to Beef, and therefore we can click on it, get detailed information about it. And if we click on the commands, we'll be able to run a large number of commands that'll allow us to do so much on that target. Now, we will go through all of that later on in the course, but the one that I want to show you right now is in the social engineering category. It basically shows a fake notification bar for Chrome browsers. So we're going to display a message saying critical update. Click here to install. And then we're going to give a link to my backdoor. So when the user clicks on that message, they will install a backdoor. Now, I've already created that backdoor and hosted it on the web server of Kali. Again, I will show you how to use that web server and I'll show you how to create backdoors later on in the course. So for now, we're just executing and running information that we already know, just as a teaser.
So I'm going to hit execute and let's go to the target browser. And as you can see, we're getting a notification bar in here telling us that there is a critical update. Click here to install. Now you could say that there is an update for Chrome or whatever. You can make this message more convincing. So if you click on install, you'll see that the file will get downloaded into my downloads just like any other file. And if I go to the downloads, let me show you what this file looks like. You will notice that the file has the right icon for the Chrome installer. So right here, I actually have a clean Chrome installer. As you can see, I'm naming it clean. And this is the one that actually contains a backdoor. So you can see the files look identical. But if I run the updates that we just downloaded, you will notice that you get this warning for running an executable. So we're going to run it for an unknown publisher. And then it's actually going to let you install Chrome, as you can see. So it's a Google update setup. If you say yes, you'll actually get the normal installer for Chrome. But if we go to the hacker machine in here and look at where I was listening for incoming connections, you will notice that I actually got a connection from the target Windows machine. So now I hacked that computer and I can do anything that the normal user can do on their computer. So I can access their file system. I can register every keystroke they type on their keyboard. I can listen to their mic. I can turn on their keyboard. I can turn on their camera. I can do anything that they can do on their computer. And just as a quick example to show you how severe this is, I'm going to do webcam list to list all of the webcams connected to this computer. And as you can see, we have only one webcam. So I'm going to do webcam stream number one, the first camera. And if I hit enter, we can see a live stream of the target person. Now, this is just one example of what you're going to learn in this course. And like I said, don't worry about the technical aspects. I've connected a number of attacks here in order to achieve this, but we're going to focus and cover every single piece of the puzzle that allowed us to do this. So don't worry about it at all. This is just a teaser to show you what you're going to be able to do by the end of the course.
Hello and welcome. My name is Zaid. I'm an ethical hacker, a computer scientist, and I'll be your instructor in this course. In this course, I'm going to teach you ethical hacking from scratch. So I'm going to assume that you have no prior knowledge, and by the end of it, you'll be at a high intermediate level. So we'll start by teaching you how to set up a penetration testing lab and how to install the needed software so you can practice hacking safely. Once done, the course is divided into four main penetration testing sections. The first is the network hacking section, where you'll learn how networks work, how devices communicate with each other, and how to exploit this method of communication to control all the connections around you, crack Wi-Fi keys, and gain access to Wi-Fi networks, whether they use WEP, WPA, or WPA2, and intercept data to capture usernames, passwords, chat messages, or anything that anybody does on the same network. Once done with this, we'll move to the gaining access section, where you'll learn how to gain access to servers and personal computers. So first, you'll learn how to gather comprehensive information about your target, discover vulnerabilities, and exploit them to gain full control over the target system. Not only that, but you'll also learn how to generate undetectable backdoors and use social engineering to deliver them to your target as a fake update or as a PDF or an image or any other file that they might be interested in. You'll also learn how to spoof emails so when they're delivered to your target, they appear as if they're sent from a friend, from their boss, or from any address that they're likely to interact with. Once done with all of this, we'll move to the post-exploitation section where you'll learn what can you do with the access that you gained in the previous sections. So you'll learn how to interact with the file system, how to execute system commands, record keystrokes, open the webcam, and even use the hacked computer as a pivot to hack into other computers. Once done with all of this, we'll move to the website hacking section, where you learn how websites work, how to gather comprehensive information about a target website, and how to discover and exploit a number of dangerous vulnerabilities that allow you to gain full control over the target website. At the end of each section, you learn how to secure systems and secure yourself from the discussed attacks. The first penetration testing section in this course is going to be the network hacking section. The reason why I chose to start with this, because everything, if you think of it, is connected to a network. So whether your target is a personal computer, whether it's a server, whether it's a company, or even if it's just a website, all of these systems are actually connected to a network. Literally, when you just connect to the internet, you're connecting to a network because the internet is just a really, really big network. So it is very important that you understand how networks work and how devices communicate with each other before we actually move into the next sections. So this section is actually going to be divided into three subsections. In the first subsection, we're going to talk about all of the attacks that you can do before connecting to a network. So you literally just have a computer with a network interface, possibly a Wi-Fi adapter. And we're going to see what can you do now before even connecting to anything. In the second subsection, I'm going to show you how to crack Wi-Fi keys and gain access to Wi-Fi networks, whether they use WEP, WPA, or WPA2. Once you have the access, you can move to the third section, which will apply for both Wi-Fi and wired networks. All of the attacks that you will learn in the third subsection apply whenever you are able to connect to the network, once you're able to gain access to the network. And here is where the real fun starts, because you're going to learn a number of powerful attacks that will allow you to intercept the connections in the network and capture everything sent in it, including usernames, passwords, URLs, chat messages, and so on. Not only that, but you'll also be able to modify data as it's being sent in the air. So you'll be able to control requests, serve people fake updates, inject evil code into the pages that they load, and so many other cool things. So everything in the third section will apply for both Wi-Fi and wired networks.
Now, before leaving this section and move into the gaining access section, where I'm going to teach you how to break the different encryptions and gain access to networks, I want to spend one more lecture talking about a really useful attack that still falls under the pre-connection attacks under this section. The attack that I want to talk about is the deauthentication attack. This attack allows us to disconnect any device from any network before connecting to any of these networks and without the need to know the password for the network. To do this, we're going to pretend to be the client that we want to disconnect by changing our MAC address to the MAC address of that client and tell the router that I want to disconnect from you. Then we're going to pretend to be the router again by changing our MAC address to the router's MAC address and tell the client that you requested to be disconnected, so I'm going to disconnect you. This will allow us to successfully disconnect or deauthenticate any client from any network. Now, we're actually not going to do this manually. We're going to use a tool called AirplayNG to do that. From the previous lecture, we know that this MAC address right here belongs to an Apple computer. And like I said, this Apple computer is actually my computer right here. And as you can see, this host machine is connected to this network right here, which is the same as the one that you see in here. And it actually has internet access. So if I just look for test, you'll see that I'm connected and I can look for things, I can use Google, so I have a proper working internet connection. Now, we're gonna come back here and we're gonna use a tool called AirplayNG to launch the deauthentication attack and disconnect this Mac computer from the internet. So, we're gonna type the name of the program, which is AirplayNG. We're gonna tell it that I want to run a deauthentication attack. Then I'm gonna give it the number of deauthentication packets that I want to send. So I'm gonna give it a really large number so that it keeps sending these packets to both the router and the target device. Therefore, I'll disconnect my target device for a very long period of time. And the only way to get it back to connect is to hit Control C and quit AirplayNG. Next, I'm gonna give AirplayNG the MAC address of my target network. So I'm gonna do dash A and give it the MAC address, which I'm gonna copy from here. Then I'm gonna use dash C to give it the MAC address of the client that I want to disconnect. And the client that I want to disconnect is this client right here, which is the Apple computer, like we said. So I'm gonna copy it and paste it here. If your target network runs on the 5 GHz frequency, then you'll have to add dash capital D to the command in here. But my target, as you can see, it uses 2.4 GHz. Therefore, I don't need to do this. And I'm simply just gonna add my wireless card in monitor mode, which is mon 0. Now it's very important to understand that this command will only disconnect the target client from the specified network. So if there are other networks that the target client can connect to, it will automatically connect to them. So in many cases, it might connect to the 5 GHz version of the network, or it might connect to a completely different network that it already knows the password to. And if it's a mobile device, it might even continue to have internet access through its mobile data plan. So it might seem like the attack did not work, but it actually worked, and the client just disconnected from this network and is using another network. To solve this, all you have to do is simply open up a new terminal window and run the exact same command, but this time target the new network that the client connected to. I actually cover that along with more advanced topics in my advanced network hacking course. Check out the bonus lecture, the last lecture of this course, for more information about my advanced network hacking course and all of the other courses that you can take along with this course. So a very, very simple command. We're typing aireplyng. This is the name of the program that we're going to use. We're doing dash dash deauth to tell aireplyng that I want to run a deauthentication attack. I'm giving it a really large number of packets so that it keeps sending the deauthentication packets to both the router and the client and keep the client disconnected. I'm using dash A to specify the MAC address of the target router or the target access point. Then I'm using dash C to specify the MAC address of the client. Finally, I'm giving it mon 0, which is the name of my wireless adapter in monitor mode. Now you can run this command like this, and in most cases it would work, but in very rare cases, this command will fail unless aerodump ng is running against the target network. So what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna go back to my first terminal in here, and I'm going to run aerodump ng using the command that we've seen before. And I don't want to write anything to a file, so I'm going to remove the write argument. So I'm just doing a normal aerodump ng command. I'm literally just giving it the BSS ID of my target network, and I'm giving it the target channel. And then I'm just going to hit enter. We've seen how to do this. We spent a full lecture on it. That's why I did it really quick. And then I'm going to go back to the command that we wrote so far, and I'm going to hit enter. Now, as you can see, aireplyng, it's telling me that it's sending the deauthentication packets. And if we go back here and look up, you can see that I actually lost my connection and I'm trying to connect back. So obviously, if I try to look for anything, so let's say test 2, you'll see I'll get stuck and nothing will load for me. So the only way for me to connect back is if I go back here, if I quit this by doing Control C, quit this again, and now my machine should be able to connect back and restore its connection. This is actually very, very handy in so many ways. It's very useful in social engineering cases where you could disconnect clients from the target network and then call the user and pretend to be a person from the IT department and ask them to install a virus or a backdoor, telling them that this would fix their issue. You could also create another fake access point and get them to connect to the fake access point and then start spying on them from that access point. And we'll see how to do that later on in the course. And you can also use this to capture the handshake, which is what happened in here actually. And this is vital when it comes to WPA cracking. And we'll talk about this once we get to the WPA cracking section. So, like I said, this is a small attack that can be used as a plugin to other attacks or to make other attacks possible. Everything we've done so far can be done without the need to connect to the target network. Now, once we connect to the network, we can do so many cool things. We'll be able to gather so much more info. We'll be able to intercept the connections and see everything that the people send, whether it's usernames, passwords, URLs, or anything really. We'll also be able to modify the data, and you'll see all of this in the next section of this course. Now, if your target does not use encryption, then you can just connect to it. If your target is a wired network, then you can just use a cable and connect to it and move to the next section. The only problem is if your target is using encryption. So in this section, I'm going to show you how to break that encryption and gain access to Wi-Fi networks, whether they use WEP, WPA, or WPA2. Once we get the key, we'll be able to connect to the network and you'll be able to do all of the things that you'll learn in the next section, in the post-connection section.
In this section, we're going to talk about post-connection attacks, so attacks that you can do after connecting to your target network. Now, it doesn't matter whether the target network is a Wi-Fi network or a wired or an Ethernet network. It really doesn't matter. As long as you gained access to this network, as long as you're able to connect to it, you'll be able to do all of the attacks that I'm going to show you in this section. Now, you'll notice once connected, you can do so many cool things. So you'll be able to gather detailed information about all of the clients connected to the same network. You'll also be able to intercept data and see any usernames, passwords, or any information they use on the internet. You'll be able to modify data as it's being sent in the air, so you'll be able to inject evil code and do so many cool things on the network. Now, to do all of the attacks that I'm going to show you in here, you have two options. The first option is to run the attacks against the virtual NAT network against the Windows machine. You just need to make sure that the virtual Windows machine is connected to the same NAT network as the Kali machine. Or you can run the attacks against real computers connected to your real Wi-Fi network. And you need to make sure that you have a wireless interface connected to the Kali machine, and the Kali machine needs to be connected to your target Wi-Fi network. Now, throughout this section, I'm actually going to be using both options. So I'm going to be running some attacks against the Wi-Fi network, and I'll be running some against my virtual NAT network, just to make sure that you're comfortable with running all of these attacks in different environments and in different networks. Because like I said, it doesn't really matter how you gained your access to the network. The network type doesn't really matter either, as long as you are able to connect to the target network.